Thank you. Thanks for introduction. Oh, is the mic okay? Okay, good. All right. Oops. Okay, you need the help. No, I guess the connection is the problem. Okay. So while it's fixing, it's good to be here. Nice weather. the environment. I think that I'm going to talk about with my project that how we consider the environment. I think the environment condition actually is, it affect the people's psychology a lot. So. It's good, and that you guys had a great environment, so you can recreate that environment in your design. Okay, I think is it ready? I'm going to talk about today. My title is microurbanism. So this urbanism, but this is this sort of a, we try to. Address this new way to set up urban condition. Okay. Right. Good. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. I think it's good. Okay. Great. So before I go into the lecture about the microurbanism, I'm gonna talk about the. Our office, briefly, we have office in New York and Seoul, two micro office, and we work separately and together. So when we, is that the reason why is that we have a physical setup in two location, although these days you can actually handle from one location and then handle the virtually. But we do that to set up closer relationship with the client and the local collaborators, and also this the physical experience that you get in that the location. So it's different climate condition, different culture. The which we learn a lot, and then when we need to work in the more pressing project with the high-speed project or the bigger project, we collab, two office work together. And with the time differences, we can actually run sometimes 24 hours operation. So these are the location of our project. We travel a lot. And when we deal with the architecture in any scale of a building, that we have to deal with all these different aspects, and this approach, the convergent approach that we take, which is we consider all these different kind of aspect in the beginning of the design, instead of solving one at a time, which does this additive approach. So which that makes the single speed design, which is SSD stands for. So people ask about the name, origin of the name, but it came from single speed bike. So the microurbanism is the theme, and I've been researching and working on this concept for the several years. So I'm gonna talk about this with the project, our project, and how we test out the idea, and then how hopefully solve some problems and introduce new potential. So we set up this pair of the idea that seemingly. Contradict each other, but the that with the combination of those two words, that we can actually come up with the more inventive idea when we try to serve this the aspect on both end of the spectrum. So first thing is the physical and perceptual. So this is the project that we did in Gwangju Biennale. So this is two meter by two meter box that this we are asked to design, and the whole idea is the based on this traditional the pavilion that is in Korea. So from outside you can see the clear definition, and through this the curved the gap that when you enter, so you can get this the boundaryless space, infinite space, so that you can see the conversion of the, you know, the this type boundary to the infinite infinite boundary, and the also the, you know, curved plane that forms in, you know, different way. The plane actually forms the volume. So it's our effort to also represent the idea in graphic. So this, you know, from the there's a outside, and from inside you see this infinite reflection and infinite space. So this is very the small and short project that we can really test out through the reflection and the visual, through the inversion of the elements. We can push the, you know, perceptual space. So which is I'm gonna talk about more. Next idea is owning and sharing. So this is the loft space that we designed in Manhattan, Chelsea area. The client were is unique. There are like three families. They want us to design for them to share. So the first actually they came approached to us with this almost a set up plan. With the, you know, this you can see the existing plan, and you have glazing in the both end. Then they wanted to have like six rooms, so they can have each member or each family can have their own space. So what we proposed is this some convertible space that they can actually convert, and it can become it provides six rooms, but sometimes it can use as one big rooms. So when we started this project, we looked at the client and their lifestyle further. So we found that this map out this potential user of this this type of space. So and when you look at the residents in the hyper dense city like Manhattan, then people actually travel all the time, so that, you know, if you look at actual occupancy, actually it's pretty low. So if we make something some space that can be shareable, so we mapped out those essential space that each user would need, and then we can increase the the occupancy ratio. So like we call that this as a parenthetical space, so like a parenthesis in the sentence, you know, depending on the where that is, actually change the meaning of the sentence. So the space actually can be converted to fit in their need. So we extend this idea in urban scale. So you can see this very dense urban condition. If you look at the occupancy ratio, then it's quite porous. So if we densify in one location, then we get, you get this the empty space, enough space for other program, like a public library, park. So going back to the space itself, so the wall in the middle get the placed in diagonal way to open up the view to the primary side where the Empire State Building is, so that you can get the, you can maximize the view. Actually, that diagonal wall also allow the, you know, the room in the other side also can have a view. So the view to the major major side. Okay, let me. The pointer. I'm trying to make the pointer works, but okay. I found it. There. Okay, here. Yeah. And this the wall also it can be used as a there's a individual locker for each members, and also the some part becomes desk, some part becomes entry doors, and things like that. And this the material use of this the wall is that we use the this the frosted glass with the chrome back paint, so that the wall itself actually the diffuse the light, reflect the natural light, and sort of emit through the space, so that can reduce the use of artificial light. And the, also the this the curtain is aluminum mesh curtain, so the curtain defines the space, but at the same time that also defines the path. You can see the this gap. This is a sort of a secret door to the kids' bedroom, so which is also a closet for them. And with the same material, we often with the try to maximize the use of the same material. So by simply locating the lighting, the outside and inside, and by turning on and off, you can vary the opacity of that same material. So if you lit outside, it looks opaque. If you lit inside, it looks transparent. And with the same idea of a parenthesis, we designed this sliding shelving. So it's by sliding horizontally, actually you can adjust the height between the shelf. So we like that idea. Next one is the contracting and expanding. And we test out the idea with this house that we built in Newton, Massachusetts. And as you can see, this is a sort of a typical condition of a suburb where that is the or the houses get is placed in quite tightly. This is the condition that you see. This is usually what happened in the suburb that where people want to maximize the buildable area. So they build this huge house up to the lot. And what we proposed is instead of building a big house, building the smaller house, but you feel more spacious. So the feeling, the spaciousness is more important than actual physical size. That's what we are trying to convince the client. And also we sort of map out this landscape so that it can be this much of a landscape needs to be maintained. So there's many advantage of this this strategy, and when we once we convince that we can actually increase the budget per square foot. So they really have to feel that spaciousness. So from this, the photo shows this living room that actually the, your actual boundary is within the glass enclosure, but then your perceptual boundary actually goes beyond the physical boundary. So within the boundary, within this the space, you actually have a interior space and exterior space, which creates this diversity on the in the same same boundary. You can see more clearly in this plan that you have this outdoor space and indoor space, which can be quite useful in the in a good weather. And also, even cold weather, so you get this visual access to the the manicured garden there. This dining area also have that condition, so you have an extension, and you have the indoor setting and outdoor setting at the same time. So this is the living room, and this is dining room. Condition. So it also the increased spaciousness of the psychology. So like it feel because you can the actually go in and out within the space more that that you feel more the space that you feel is more much more bigger than what it is. And also, throughout our project, we are trying to use also, in the beginning I talked about the environment. We're trying to use natural ventilation and natural heating. Natural cooling that throughout our project, actually we convinced our client not to have air conditioner. So this is the one of the project, and so we placed this shaft that draws the cold air, and then that brings in hot air that release the hot air through the skylight. But then you have the same strategy, but also I wanted to have that those space is not just hidden or cavity behind the wall, but it also works as a part of the space. So it's bringing the extra spaciousness into the space like tight space like a bathroom. So that actually the help to make the the space better and actually functionally works better. Second floor. And so when we compare this with this typical house, that actually you also get a very short view to the neighbor if you have maximized the lot. And by shifting the box and the vertically and horizontally, we can get this extended view to outside and in the sectionally also, you can get extended view to the street, to the ground, and also to the sky. So through that, this shifting action, through the geometry, we get this the sort of awning over the window, and you get the awning over the balcony, things like that. And the other sustainable feature of this is the solar heating, hot water heater. So that panel is the you can see it profile a little bit. It's a usually very not prison looking. So we sort of slanted the roof in certain angles, so from the ground, actually you don't see that. So this is the view from the ground. So we actually this fence also brings in certain boundary, so that you know the owner of this house actually can take care of only the inside of that, and outside of the fence actually he can live in relatively natural and wild. So that is actually he's the owner right there. This is he asked us to design the house that he can actually spend the rest of his life. He just retired, so he's not okay, not expecting to die soon, but that's his request. So the half level change is also that is a part of that scheme. And so next one is timing and programming, which is the more and more gain more and more experience that we see this part actually becoming more and more important. So programming is not something that the client gives you. You have to suggest the programming and different type of or different use of a program. Actually, you have to suggest in order to the push your idea through, and also bring out the more efficiency of the project. So this is the project that we propose as a part of Ordos 100. I don't know if you remember. I think it's 2008. The Ai Weiwei and Harjong and Dimeron invited 100 architects to design the 100 villa like this. So you see the this one is a Ai Weiwei. And probably you recognize some of the face. So it's 100 architects in one spot. It was quite intense. Of course, people in competition. The regardless of this intensity, this site of the site condition is very undescriptive. It's just a desert, nothing there. There are no line, no street, and they're building the street, and they're like planting the trees one by one. They in the far distance that looks like a mountain, but it's not. It's like a dune, but they're planting the trees one by one. So it's a sort of the blank site without any context that we can actually grab. So we looked at the basic program of the requirement of the house. So we looked at the basic program and the characteristic of program. So we made it this 8 towers with the program. So we are asked to build 36 rooms. So we stacked each rooms by the same program to make 8 towers. 8 also is a the lucky number in Chinese culture, so it was a conscious decision. So then depending on the time of day, actually you can turn on and off the tower. So there's bedroom tower, living tower, kitchen tower, workout tower, and things like that. So that also turning on and off, it should reduce the use of energy. And also the, you know, this, the, if we, you know, there's a, the many scheme actually made this as one volume, then the inside, you don't get the sunlight, but the, because it's tower, each room can have a natural ventilation and natural light. And also that breaks down this massive volume of the house. So each tower have different the special condition. So from entry tower, so you get this the cascade of the light from the skylight, and then from the bedroom, the living tower, you get this the view to the sky, because it's as you saw in the urban planning, it was very tightly located, so you don't get much of privacy in horizontal, you know, straightforward horizontal way. So the you draw the view to the sky, and also when we do that, and even like this very private program can have a spectacular view. So each the because all the level is different. So but the even if it's the same program, actually there's a different location. So it creates the different spatial quality and different relationship to the outside. And the structure scheme that we were asked to use the local technology, which is the RC. And so we slanted just enough so that centroid of the panel can stay in the foundation. And so from the basement is more connected. And then as you go up, the tower gets split up. To bring the light in all the way down to the ground level, underground level, and the ventilation also can happen. So through this collision of a tower, actually you get this unexpected moment, and then you sort of peek through between the towers. During the night, should the courtyard, the light, so that it creates more like a community, like atmosphere than just one single massive house. For the landscape, we put the clay pot, so because it's sandy area, that the water doesn't stay. So by planting those, so they can control the vegetation there. And also this, after rain, that creates the temporary reflecting pool that also reflects the building that also creates this elongated look of the tower. Next one, division and continuity. So this one is, we call that as mini orders, is the development that planned in Portland, Oregon. So not 100, but 14 architects were invited. So we sort of intentionally choose the smallest lot, 16 feet by 16 feet, to create this single tower house. Part of a requirement of this is, interestingly enough, because of this developer also understand that the architects wants to do design something that sometimes hard to sell. So they ask us to come up with a marketing strategy also. So this is our marketing strategy. Hopefully, there was supposed to be animation. It's like Star Wars. So sort of
hypnotic image. We call this manifesto, so people can, you know, if people see this, they have to, you know, create their life, and you don't need a lot of things, and those kind of the brainwashing we are trying to do. So for the design, and we looked at the sort of daily activity, so we mapped out daily activity, we define the minimum space that daily activity needs, and then we sort of compose this into, you know, the different configuration. And so there can be many different variation with this this part. And then when we design, and this is one of the example, I think I actually showed to my students also, that the diagram also the guides the design. So that when you after we draw this, we looked at this. Oh, it looks like a musical note. And what if we apply that, and, you know, we can, we haven't, but we are trying to actually play this as a music, and then, you know, try to see the, what is the relation between this with the spatial condition and the, you know, the sound. The idea is that every horizontal surface becomes the usable or programmable space. So we stack in a certain way, so we don't have the residual space. So because you have a very like a fine degree of division throughout the space, we wanted to emphasize that by creating this very clear outside inside envelope condition, so there's no clear window. This is the almost like hedge. So you have a translucent wall, but then the open or closed kind of a condition. And the Portland the climate condition actually allow us to have something like that. And we also use the standard size of the lumber to create that house. Then we're gonna jump to scale a little bit. So future and past. This is the proposal that we did for Incheon, South Korea. So the condition of this is the something like this, where that you have this inner sea, and this you can see this almost the infield area, and then this is the competition about this whole area that they still call this area by the name of this island that you see only the hint of that. It used to be like that. So it was a literary island, and there's a path that appears depending on the tide. So that actually brings in a lot of memory, a lot of history. For many people, that they used to be famous for date spot. So when couple go there for a picnic, and because they sort of, you know, caught in the moment, so the path get disappear because it's a, you know, high tide, and they have to stay in their the island. So it's that, you know, that accumulates the a lot of different, you know, the good memory actually, and also there's some kind of event happen. So that, as you can see, that sort of would disappear, the characteristic of island, this area completely lost. So we're trying to bring that back by creating the island, characteristic of an island. So we brought the water to the other side, and then you know that also brings in more active circulation throughout this space, because this is it's not still water, it's part of the seawater. So through the tidal action, that you get this the accumulation of sediment, and then you can bring in more wildlife. And also what we looked at is that because it's the used to be a fishery village, the fishing industry is gone as the city got developed more and more dense. So the fishermen sort of abandoned their ships and the buoys and ropes. So it became a huge pollutant. So we tried to use that. So with the abandoned ship, that we made it this artificial reef, and with the buoy and rope, we proposed this floating bridge, so that connects the land and the island, and without disturbing the underwater condition. So we, hopefully we bring this species that we lost, and to create this eco park around here. And also the idea of the bridge is not just the bridge that you you use to link one side to the other, but this is the bridge that actually you can stay. So there's several strands of the bridge so that it can work as a more like a plaza during certain event. The next one is diversity and density. And this is the galleries that we designed in the Inheri. This is a competition. We got a call from Korea to enter this competition. And only one requirement they pressed was a flexible space. So they didn't have a idea about what kind of work they're gonna exhibit. And so, but in their mind, there's the exhibit space, so it needs to be flexible. So it's one big space from their perspective, one big space that they can put the division later on. So, which is the true for the many exhibition space. And so what we propose it is, instead of that, we propose actually the many the space that with the specific proportion and the lighting condition. So we brings in, we propose the this diversity of in terms of proportion and the lighting conditions, so that curator can actually find the perfect spot. So the site is in front of the pond. So we wanted to open view for the neighbor to the pond, and then also keep the view to the from the roof deck. And the whole area of this the site is actually very close to the borderline to North Korea. So the there's a sort of a underlying pressure that you can almost feel, because you can literally see North Korea from this area. So it looks very the calm and peaceful, but then it's the military zone. So there's a very very strong height regulation. So in order to achieve the desirable FAR, maximize FAR, big, in order to have a big open space, is what you get is just this kind of pancake space that that becomes homogeneous throughout. So we are what we propose is this sort of diverse array of the space. So through the viewing circulation, you actually go. You can feel the expansion and contraction of this the space throughout, and then you sort of you go in the this blank box, but then go out. Then you get you get the view to the nature. So this constant the alteration of this the condition actually that helps the and to bring in more dynamic viewing experience throughout. By the way, that actually the animation is very simple animation that we did the right before we our presentation, and that is the presentation material that actually got us the project. So, yeah, think about the presentation. So the for structural idea, so instead of having the fewer but bigger column, we sort of divide the column area into many, so that it becomes the in a part of a wall, so we call wallum. And the so from the entry that you have this curved glass. Curved entry that when you go enter, that you sort of the circulation the whole circulation actually was very important. So the visitor actually is guided by this slanted the glass. So to bring the to bring this visitor to this spot, which is the beginning of the you know the whole circulation departure. Actually, it's just a slanted glass, but it really worked. Otherwise, people just go straight forward to the this area, which is the because there is the pond. So, and we really like test out how this architecture element actually can work very actively to. Actually, to guide the people and affect the you know the people's behavior. So there's a, like a different you know the exhibition space, and we named this as box. So the white block gallery actually, the name white block gallery came in later. So this is a tall box with say like seating box and hanging box and things like that. Naming actually is also a very important that the client usually don't have a good idea or the deeper understanding, and is it actually helps to name in certain way so that actually becomes a guidance for the client also for other the collaborator like engineers also. This space that the client can use as an exhibition space. So throughout this the central space, actually you can get the natural ventilation through this operable window, which is unusual for the exhibition space. It's a hanging box. You have the light from the sky. That you see this is the sort of the scene that shows this being an inside and very controlled space, and also the you know the outside of this you know the open space to outside. So this constant shift actually helps the people to. Sort of get away from this the phenomena of a museum headache. So when you are in you know the museum too long, you know you get headache. So So you're trying to break off and you know, bring in more casual viewing experience. So in here, we try to maximize the usable exhibition space. So even like this fire stairs can work as exhibition space. And you know, this area, again, the climate condition is foggy because it's near the water. And we also wanted to design the building that can communicate with the change of season. So this the clear area can be filled with this the pear tree blossom. And so the different the season that you can read the the space indifferently. And we built this program to locate the fruit pattern. And we also wanted to be fruit pattern be more functional, so that can control the heat gain and the glare in the space. So these are the template that we could use because with the the budget limitation. So out of this the 10 pattern, we try to make more organic like facade throughout. So I talked about the this more building, and now I want to talk about this more that relates to activity. So surveillance and amenity is another theme. That so the Arab is not our graphic. Arab did. So in order to reduce the carbon footprint, usually the more than anything else, actually behavior change actually the affect most. So we talked about we're thinking about this. When you build this system in urban condition, you can start with this hard infrastructure that you usually handle. And then, but more and more, the soft infrastructure becomes important. So when we work this thing together, how we can create more increase the performance of the this urban condition. So that was our question, and this is one of the project that we actually got to build in next to the gallery, but it's originally actually designed. Designed for this the underutilized and also a lot of the crime scene happening plaza in Providence, and so this is the light and sound installation that we use the surveillance the data from the surveillance camera to make this visually and also soundly entertaining interactive piece. So it sensor the movement of the people, and also it sensor the weather change. So it interact with the the nature change or in people's change. So here's a video. Not working. okay. No, this is not the okay. Sorry about that. Okay, I'm gonna. This is actually on our website, so visit our website. so that the interact with the climate condition and also the people's behavior is almost like a cloud where that is a visualization of this almost invisible like water molecule. So the cloud actually in this this cloud actually the it becomes one of this visualization of invisible or the untractable the movement. So the next, microurbanism. I was going to talk about with this is Songpa microhousing. That so that is built in this Jamsil area where that is you see this massive amount of housing happen. So as we looked at this the housing, and then it sort of provided this. Very rigid condition for the living, and then we saw a lot of limitation. As we looked at this data, this is the nuclear family, which is the very typical family type. That is at 31% in the 1995. This is a Korea case, but then this type of family actually gets reduced by up to under 10%. So then all this other, 90% of the, that occupied by all this different type of family that you see. There's single parents family and, the couple with a kid and people live longer and things like that. So this is the one of the, things that usually all the housing is that their potential user actually is for this nuclear family. Then how did we can actually create the next typology for the housing? That was the question. And we also looked at the fluctuation of the size of the family and the duration of the family. So. Conventionally, actually, the family size is gets bigger and bigger. Then you added the member of a family, but that is no longer true. So, this is the U.S. Data. 18 years old, until you get married, right? And then you have a kid, and then you divorce. And then you remarry, so you get this. It's not always growing, right? Sometimes you get the smaller, and then that sort of circulation goes on with the your kids too. So then, everybody is gone, your spouse is gone, and then you become alone. But then you actually live longer. So this whole, the rapid change of the family size and the shorter duration of that family size, actually that is also we looked at. And then the other part of this type of this project, actually that we wanted to, this is sort of the new type, so we also wanted to come up with a development plan. So this is the existing building that we actually award this building to the artist, so the artist can use as the material, and so we can bring in the art funding. At the same time, that actually bring some story in this very remote area. So this becomes that creates a certain vibrant activities in this remote spot. So this is as you can see, this is the sort of a middle income class or middle or lower income class the area, but then. You see the our building actually stands out. It looks quite different. So that was the part of a consideration, how we can actually help the client to be able to develop something like this. So going back to the each unit, so this is the unit that actually we went for the smallest size, smallest legal size, which is 12 square meter. So the idea of this unit development is that we use the analysis of tapioca. So there's a core private gel, hard core, but this is surrounded by this gel. So through this gel interaction, that you can actually expand your private area to the you know, certain boundary. So we sort of, in order to increase the efficiency of construction, we kept this unit type into two proportion. So the square and rectangular. So, but then the depending on the how the unit gets located, depending on the surrounding condition, actually the characteristic of the unit can be changed. So, for instance, like same rectangular unit, this we map out the potential user. So, green thumb, for instance, can maximize the use of this balcony to grow the plant. And for the film critic, can take advantage of this blank wall that is a projection screen. Which that goes beyond the boundary they actually own. So although their the physical boundary is limited, their activity can go beyond their boundary. That was our idea, and also. Each unit actually get connected outside of this corridor, so that the unit can be combined. So there is the idea of actually expansion of a contraction. So you can see like this unit can be combined, or this three can be combined, or four can be combined. So during the construction, actually we sort of switched and actually not we. The client switched the they wanted to increase the bigger size of number of the bigger size units, so we combined it in a couple of the unit to make a bigger unit. So the combination of this unit actually can happen more easily in this system. And also the because of the unit is so small, that we put a lot of consideration and bring in the natural light, natural ventilation. So at least two operable window that the unit can have, and also that we sort of bring in the view. So view is another one that affect the quality of living space. So even like this remote spot is embedded unit can get a view through this the stairs, the fire stairs to the sky. So as you can see, this the building or the lot is very densely located. So you don't get actually privacy to the adjacent building. So from there, through the void, you can actually the locate the window without hurting the neighbors the privacy. You see this is another connection to the outside, the connection to the other unit. And there's the idea of a clear story throughout, that which brings in the light from all sides, because we had to maximize the use of the wall space as a storage space. So this is one of the scene that shows the connected space. Okay. Okay, that red dot, I cannot move it. So, okay, sorry about that. It's gonna stay there for entire lecture. And then this is the, sort of the space in between the unit. The also provides the extra outdoor space from each unit. So even very small space like this actually affect the perceptual space in the unit for the residents. So we found that works really nicely. Again, the clear story, which I cannot point out, but you can see the clear story in the upper area that also cut away the idea of a box. So that we try to get rid of the corner that creates this very encased the space. This is one of the smallest unit. There you see the sliding coming from all sides, so it's very well lit. There's no the shadow that's cast by the lighting that coming from the one side, and it's a sort of a subdivision. So you get up. You put up, and then this is shower enclosure. So entire thing becomes shower enclosure, and you get have access to outside also. And then there you have a lookout, and then get out. So throughout the development, actually, we the further development of this system, we are trying to implement the technology, so the smart technology that we can also implement. We talk with the corporations, and they're also very interesting. So there's the next step that we are trying to make it work. The other issue of this project is that this area, that because of parking requirement, the ground level is the most of the ground actually used as a parking area. So you can see the building next to our building, that the ground floor actually is all parking. So even though this is the residential area, like on the street, you don't see the people, there's no interaction. So we are trying to reduce the required parking number by actually reducing the interior space of the unit, which triggers the number of parking requirement. And then we can actually bring down or bring up the program on the ground level so that we can increase the activity. So from the ground, you get a, through the void, you can actually see the program underground, which is the gallery and cafe. And through the entry that you you walk down, there is the cafe, that the micro cafe. So the stairs works as a seating during the day, and then it works as a theater during the night. So you see the this acoustic panel is a three-layer glazing. To observe the sound, and this is a residential area, so it's very sensitive about implementing this kind of program. But then with the glazing system, actually we completely capture the sound inside. Then the idea of this is again that motivate and convince the client to develop this type of complex but small but complex project is that even though the space itself is small, but he can run the use of the space 24 hours or more extended hours, so actually he can increase the profit And the second floor, actually, during the construction, he wanted to make it as a gallery, so that the second floor actually turned it into gallery. But that worked very well with this many walls and divisions and things like that. So this the program of gallery actually is very, very important, and the program of the theater and the cafe, because this is small development, and each program they benefit mutually benefit. So for instance, the residents, go to cafe, and then they do the, they use that as an extension of their unit, and then they eat there, they get drink. Actually, they get the morning coffee free. And the cafe, the owner of a cafe, who is also the young chef, he can also do the catering for the exhibition opening for the gallery. So there is a sort of the interaction and between these different parties that which we see this big potential that also creates this big community. The idea of in the beginning I actually forgot to mention the idea of creating the many different type of building. Different size, so that when you increase the family size, you don't have to move out of the building. You can actually you can stay there, and that actually elongates the people's stay, and that the also that sort of that helps to build a community between the residents. So which we see that it's a big potential. It's due to the void space from the ground. And all of this idea actually is not the concept that we brought in. We developed all this idea by looking at the surrounding condition. So we looked at as the condition, and that you see the all this sort of a cluttered addition that the people added later on, so we look at those condition, and then we sort of mapped out the physical condition of that, and then we made this the screen that works in different function throughout. So the sometimes that the works is the security screen or the private screen or the trailers for the the vine to grow or the bike racks, and that can becomes the guide the line to hide the conduit and things like that. So the whole screen actually works in many different functions. And of course, there's also a certain number of type that we can bring in. So we use I think 5 or 6 types to make this the more organic patterns. So through this this twisted stainless steel band that reflects the light in different way, so it sort of constantly changes the look of the facade depending on the climate condition, weather condition, and also this clear story is becomes plays an important role on this the micro housing, not only from the inside but from outside, we wanted to create this individual box is floating behind of this screen instead of just this stacked box kind of image that you see in many schemes historically. So we after this we were contacted by this developer in Malaysia. So they wanted to develop the 1,700 unit housing project. So this is the site. You can see the twin tower in the far away. So this is the it's part of KL. These are the all this development that the client developed. So they really liked the idea, and we expanded the idea more. So this we set up this basic unit. Now this case is 400 square feet instead of 120 square feet. So, and there is a sort of this tapioca space that can happen. And through the combination, many combination, that we can actually create the diverse unit. Actually, we use this is the columbae that you can see. So this that works with the parking column, parking division in the ground floor. So we did that the very regular division. Actually, we can create this diverse combination. So these are the different type of the unit that we can have there. You know, from studio to we said like a signature mansion. So it's the last name. It's a C. Chen. It's actually the client's last name, so he can have this big mansion there. In the aggregation, because of this climate condition, the Malaysia is located near equator, so the sun is in the right above your head. So actually creating shading is very, very important. So within the construction method they can offer, we cantilever setback a little bit and cantilever. So we create this curve that also brings in the shading condition. And then also is creates a nice curve. So we worked with the Transola. And they did this analysis of this how this the curvature actually works with the climate condition, and also the porosity that we built in that helps the ventilation throughout. And through the whole organization, we build this amenity. It's a sort of individual amenity is small. But then we can connect all this the different amenity because of the, it has a huge scale. So again, this combination of the scale and diverse scale can happen in this the amenity space. And this the overall view. So through this loop, we get this. Different courtyard condition. And then this is the final image that of entry that is sort of the bring-ins, the little bit concealed but still open entry throughout this entire complex. But then we basically apply the same logic, like ventilation, natural light, and the view was the main consideration. This is just end of concept design. So that was it. Just end of. Yeah, I'd like to get the actual question because I didn't want to spend too much time. I don't know if I ended up actually spend too much time. But I'd like to get the question and I can answer Any question? Yes?
I was wondering on the cloud project that you built with the interactive lights.
Uh-huh. The program that you meant, the interactive, the program part of, we work with the, we work with the programmer. Yeah, yeah. But we, the, we come up with the design of the lighting. So lighting effect also we designed, with the template they gave us. So, and then the sound effect also we designed. No more question. I'm just trying to get this the animation work. But yes.
You mentioned how like programming a project is something that you as a designer will do instead of asking the client. Did I get that correctly?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Like the program of like a house, I think.
It was. Yep. Oh, I see.
I mean, certainly yeah. People live different lives, and so it does kind of, their lifestyle dictates the program to a certain extent, so I'm just wondering, like, how you figure through that gray area, like, what they already do, or what they
Right, yeah. Usually client, I mean, the most of the case that I presented today, the client has the when they find the architect, they usually have a preconceived idea, right? They have, oh, this is a sort of a idea, and the plan actually is there already, and the more complex project also they hire the separate programmer, things like that. So there's always the predefined condition, which is not necessarily work or the idea. It's probably most common, usually. So it's if architects analyze that and propose something that actually works the better, and we spend a lot of time that we actually research and analyze the sort of those material that client brought in. So that is the part of a effort so that we can convince the client more easily, so they can see our point of view, and then we also give them more in a way trust, so that because we are not just there to make a form, right? Make just a physical condition according to whatever they think that is right. But when we work with those base material, then actually we can do more, right? So that was the part of the effort. But more and more, because of the client usually this is very familiar with what happened. But they don't necessarily know or they expect what's happening and what's going to happen. And but when after we build things, it's already past, or we are basically building something for future, right? So it's the architect's job that actually and we are more sensitive on that change also. So okay, yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. In this micro-urbanist building, mm-hmm. where it's full of You know? You get my question?
Yeah.
I think
I do. I will answer, and then you can. So question again. Because it's small, like the micro housing is not only, you know, we are not the only one that built, right? The micro housing is actually one of the building type that you see everywhere. And there are a lot of the many other case in Korea. Also, recently, the New York City built one. And I often get invited to that occasion. And but people talk about this the use of micro housing as a part of a sort of affordable housing. I'm strongly against that because whenever I get a chance to speak in the occasion, I said, okay, that is actually it's not a good idea because it's small, it has the spatial limitation, right? And then if you marry that idea with a certain income level, then it's creating another ghetto condition. So idea of this, the creating variety of the space and that also is very important because it grabs or collects the variety of different people. So it's not only one age group or not one like a limited income group, right? So there is a diversity, there's the interaction that we can create to promote more like a sustainable community. That is actually the big part of our project. Is that answer? Yes, all right. Do you have a question?
Oh, no, you answered my question.
Oh, okay. Oh, good. Okay, yes?
Fairly similar to that question.
Mm-hmm.
I was wondering for the micro housing, how did you decide on the diversity of the spaces? How did you decide the types of people that were going to live there, and also how did you decide how to allocate them?
How do you decide the type? Well, those type that I presented with the later project, Wash's Place, that is the sort of a possible scenario. So it's not it's sort of laying out every possible unit that we can create so that. Maybe, I mean, that may not happen, not all the units may not happen, but it gives it actually choice option to the buyer, maybe to the developer. That actually our client really liked the aspect, and they are like developer. The making profit is the primary goal. So for them, like the having this flexibility of that, being able to change that number of unit type later on, actually it becomes a big benefit because this scale of a project actually takes a long time, and they started this planning with a certain market analysis, but that is actually the current. But by the time they finish that project, actually it's a new market and new change. There's only certain thing that you can project or you can expect. So they can actually during the construction they can change the combination and so we are giving them this option so they can sort of recalculate, reassess the number of units and different type and things like that. Do you have more time or?
Yeah,
That's good. Okay, good. Thank you.